بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم.
الصيام جنة. Fasting is a shield. فلا يرفث. رسول الله صلى الله عليه وسلم says فلا يرفث. So let him not speak indecently. ولا يجهل. And let him not be ignorant. What's the meaning of let him not speak indecently? Rafath means lewd, indecent talk. Now that doesn't mean that it's permissible outside the fast. No. What Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is saying, that a Muslim does not speak offensively, lewdly, or indecently. A Muslim does not swear. He does not use abusive language. He does not splutter expletives. That's not the way a Muslim speaks. A Muslim speech is noble and pure. And it's dignified. Whether he's fasting or not. However, if he is fasting, then in the state of a fast, it's a greater imperative that his speech is pure and refined. And he should make no mistake of speaking lewdly, offensively, or indecently. This is similar to what Allah Azza wa Jal says in the Holy Quran, الحج أشهر معلومات فمن فرض فيهن الحج فلا رفث ولا فسوق ولا جدال في الحج. Allah speaks about ihram. Al-hajj ashhur ma'lumat. The hajj is an obligation. And the timing of the hajj is a few known months. Shawwal, Dhul-Qa'dah, Dhul-Hijjah. فَمَنْ فَرَضَ فِيهِنَّ الْحَجَّ. So whoever makes the hajj obligatory in these months, meaning whoever consecrates themselves and enters into the state of ihram, then once they are in ihram, what should they avoid? فَلَا رَفَثْ. There should be no rafath. It's the same thing. There should be no rafath. Indecent, lewd, vulgar talk. وَلَا فُسُوق. There should be no sinning. وَلَا جِدَال. And there should be no arguing. فِي الْحَجِّ. Now, no sinning, no arguing, no lewd, indecent, offensive, vulgar talk. These are prohibitions regardless of whether a person's in the state of ihram or not. Similarly, there are prohibitions regardless of whether a person is fasting or not. So why does Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala mention these prohibitions with some emphasis? Both in the context of fasting as well as in the context of ihram. The reason is, Allahu Akbar, that even though these are normal prohibitions, if a person commits these sins of arguing, fighting, of speaking in a vulgar manner, indecently, lewdly and offensively. If anyone is guilty of these sins, it's a sin. The person incurs a sin. However, it may or it may not damage anything else at that particular time. But in the case of ihram, in hajj, and in the case of fasting, if a person engages in these sins, in these two states, then no matter how hard they may try thereafter, their ihram is actually rendered null and void. Not that their hajj is not valid, or the ihram is invalid, no. The ihram, remember, we've covered the book of hajj. Did we learn anywhere that indecent or lewd, vulgar speech violates the ihram? It doesn't. Does it break the ihram? No. But the ihram may apparently remain intact, but the spirit of the ihram has disappeared. The hajj can become meaningless. Because a person has damaged that ihram and damaged the hajj with his offensive, vulgar, rude, lewd speech, as well as his sinful behavior and his arguing with others. Similarly with the fast. The Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam says, don't speak offensively. If someone speaks offensively, is their fast broken? No. If someone fights during a fast, is the fast broken? No. If someone swears during the fast, or argues, quarrels verbally, is their fast broken? No. So the fast apparently remains intact, but the person forfeits their reward. The person loses the spirit of the fast. The good that the fast should bring about of creating taqwa, of reforming a person, making them better, and of acting as a shield protecting him or her from Allah's wrath and displeasure both in this world as well as the hereafter, all of those protections and all of those benefits have been forfeited and lost. All that happens is that the person remains hungry and thirsty. And the obligation of the fast is dropped, that's all. So the Prophet ﷺ says, fasting is a shield, but it will only remain a shield as long as you keep it intact. فَلَا يَرْفُثْ. Therefore, he should not engage in lewd, offensive, vulgar speech. He should not speak indecently. And indeed, this is one of the most noble teachings of Islam, that we have to refine our tongue. Islam is not just about prayer and pilgrimage and charity. Islam is not just about prostrating and bowing and recitation of the Qur'an. Islam is not just about worshipping the Creator. Islam is also about being mindful of the rights of Allah's creation. And that means speaking properly. Do not swear. Do not be abusive. Do not indulge in vulgar, indecent, rude speech. That is not the mark of a believer. Prophet sallallahu alayhi wasallam, the Sahaba radiallahu anhum says, لَمْ يَكُنْ فَاحِشًا وَلَا مُتَفَاحِشًا. The Prophet sallallahu alayhi wasallam was neither one of rude speech, وَلَا مُتَفَاحِشًا, nor one who would imitate or who would affectate or simulate rude speech. What's the meaning of mutafahish? The one who simulates rude speech. The meaning is, some people, what they do, it's just their habit. Now, if they want to comment on how cold the weather is, they begin the sentence with a few expletives. And then later the fact that it's cold comes along. It's stars and hyphens, stars and hyphens, cold. It's a good number of expletives, hot. Even when they're happy, they say, this is good number of expletives, good. So some people are just, they've become naturally fahish, lewd and rude, vulgar in their speech. And then others are not fahish, but what happens? Gang mentality. You see, when they're alone, they're okay. But as soon as they're with others, in order to fit in with the rest and be one of the gang, be one of the group, if 9 people are rude, why should one try to be the good boy? So he's not rude, but merely to fit in with the rest, he tries to act rude. He tries to act bad. He's not bad, but he tries to act bad. Speech and the language and vocabulary that we use is a real reflection of ourselves. That's why Allah tells us again and again, it has an effect on us. Allah says, Ya ayyuha, in Surah Al-Ahzab, Ya ayyuha alladhina amanu attaqullaha wa qulu qawlan sadida yuslih lakum a'malakum wa yaghfir lakum dhunubakum. O believers, fear Allah and say an upright word. Say a straight word. Wa qulu qawlan sadida, say a straight word. That means speak properly. Speak straight. What's the benefit of speaking straight? Allah mentions immediately thereafter, Allah will do 2 things. You speak straight, يُصْلِحْ لَكُمْ أَعْمَالَكُمْ, Allah will make good your deeds. Meaning, if you speak straight, your deeds will become good and pure. Your tongue has an effect on your arms, on your legs, and on your limbs. That's why Imam Tirmidhi rahmatullahi alayhi relates a hadith in his Sunan, that each morning, the limbs and the organs of the body, they plead with the tongue. And they say to the tongue, اتق الله فينا فإنما نحن بك فإن استقمت استقمنا وإن عوججت عوججنا. They say to the tongue, O tongue, every morning, fear Allah in us, regarding us. For we are as you are. If you are straight, we are straight. If you are bent, we are bent. That's hadith of Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wasallam. That means the tongue has a drastic and dramatic influence and impact on the limbs of the body. If a person makes good their speech, Allah will make good their deeds. If a person's tongue is straight, their deeds will be straight. If a person's tongue is bent, their deeds will be bent. So Allah says, وَقُولُوا قَوْلًا سَدِيدًا, say a straight word. What will Allah do? يُصْلِحْ لَكُمْ أَعْمَالَكُمْ, Allah will make good your deeds. And secondly, وَيَغْفِرْ لَكُمْ ذُنُوبَكُمْ, Allah will forgive you your sins. In another verse, وَقُلْ لِعِبَادِي يَقُولُ الَّتِي هِيَ أَحْسَنُ إِنَّ الشَّيْطَانِ يَنْزَغُ بَيْنَهُمْ. And say to my servants, Allah says so lovingly, and say, O Messenger of Allah, to my servants, that they only say that which is the best. Always speak the best. إِنَّ الشَّيْطَانِ يَنْزَغُ بَيْنَهُمْ. Indeed, shaitan seeks to create divisions between them. If we are careless about our speech, every word that we utter, shaitan uses that word, tries to exploit it and abuse it and create further divisions, conflicts and strife. That's why remaining silent is one of the best options. In another hadith, Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wasallam says that one utterance of the tongue during a period of fitna is like the striking of a sword. That's a hadith. One utterance of the tongue during a period of strife, of discord, of fitna, is like the striking of a sword. Meaning the damage that one strike of the sword can do, the tongue can do as much, if not more damage, especially in the period of misunderstanding, confusion and fitna. Therefore, no matter how angry we may be, how worked up we may be, the best advice of Allah and His Rasul sallallahu alayhi wasallam is to control oneself. A man asked, Ya Rasulullah, Uqbat ibn Amir radiyallahu anhu, Man najah, O Prophet of Allah, what salvation? Prophet sallallahu alayhi wasallam said, Amsik alayka lisanak wal yasa'ka baytuk wabki ala khatiyatik. Hold on fast to your tongue, let your home confine you, and weep over your sin. And in one hadith, Mu'adh ibn Jabal radiyallahu anhu says, I rode up to the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wasallam, until my knees were touching his knees. We were riding together, and then I asked him a few questions about salah, sadaqah, about iman. O Prophet of Allah, I said, tell me about those deeds that will distance me from the fire and take me closer to Jannah. So the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wasallam said, O Mu'adh, indeed you have asked about a great thing. However, despite the greatness and the magnitude of what you have asked, it's easy for one for whom Allah makes it easy. Then the Prophet ﷺ mentioned so many things, iman, salah, tahajjud, sadaqah, and so many other things. And after mentioning all of that, it's a very long hadith, Rasulullah ﷺ said to him, should I not inform you of one thing which encompasses all of that I have mentioned? So Mu'adh ibn Jabal radiyallahu anhu said, Bala ya Rasulullah, of course, O Messenger of Allah. So can you imagine the scene? The Prophet sallallahu alayhi wasallam is riding, Mu'adh ibn Jabal radiyallahu anhu is riding next to him. He has just given him a mini sermon about all the good deeds and the greatest deeds of Islam. And then the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wasallam said, should I not tell you something that encompasses all of the above? Mu'adh ibn Jabal radiyallahu anhu thought, what could that be? Of course, Ya Rasulullah. The Prophet sallallahu alayhi wasallam, with his noble fingers, put his fingers on his tongue and pulled it out. And said to Mu'adh ibn Jabal, guard this. So Mu'adh ibn Jabal radiyallahu anhu said, Ya Rasulullah, will we be taken to task and questioned about our tongues? He asked in amazement. So the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wasallam said, O Mu'adh, I thought you were the most intelligent of people. وَهَلْ يَكُبُّ النَّاسَ فِي النَّارِ عَلَىٰ وُجُوهِهِمْ إِلَّا حَصَائِدُ أَلْسِنَتِهِمْ. And is there anything that will fling people flat on their faces in the fire of Jahannam other than what their tongues reap? So Islam isn't just about prayer and pilgrimage and charity. Guard the tongue, guard the tongue.